Welcome to Electrical Engineering 3300 at the University of Utah. Lecture number 6, we're going to talk about lossless transmission lines. The reason these are so important is because most of our lines can be considered lossless most of the time. In our transmission lines, if you recall, we normally model these as R, L, G, C lines. In a lossless line, that means that our resistance is zero and our conductance is zero, and we are left strictly with an inductor and a capacitor. That's a resonant circuit where the L and the C can self-resonate, and that gives us a transmission line behavior where the magnitude of the wave will stay exactly the same down the whole transmission line. The propagation constant, which is alpha plus J beta, for a lossless line, alpha will be zero. That gives us J omega square root of LC. Beta then is omega square root of LC, and the characteristic impedance, Z naught, is the square root of L divided by C. The wavelength is always 2 pi divided by beta, and that gives us 2 pi divided by omega square root of LC. The velocity of propagation is another factor that we need, and that is always omega divided by beta. For a lossless transmission line, it's 1 over the square root of LC. Now there's another special case of lossless transmission line, and that's the TEM line. Any line that has two conductors can be considered to be a TEM line, so most of the lines that we're going to work with follow this case. In that case, LC just happens to be mu epsilon, where mu and epsilon describe the material that's in between, that's the insulator of the transmission line. In that case, beta is omega over the square root of mu epsilon, or actually it's not divided by, it's multiplied by, and the velocity of propagation is 1 over the square root of mu epsilon. And for air, let's see what happens. If we take this as 1 over mu naught epsilon naught square root, that's going to give us C naught, which is about 2.996 times 10 to the 8th meters per second. That's the velocity of the wave in free space, which means that if a TEM transmission line is filled with air, that the velocity of propagation on it is going to be is going to be the speed of light. Remember that in general, epsilon is epsilon r, epsilon naught, and that mu is mu r, mu naught. That gives us the velocity of propagation is the speed of light divided by the square root of epsilon r for a lossless TEM transmission line. The wavelength is the velocity of propagation divided by the frequency, which ends up being the wavelength in air divided by the square root of epsilon r. Now this is really cool because it means that all of our major parameters, such as these, are strictly a function of the material that we're using as the insulation of the transmission line. Now another interesting factor happens on transmission lines, and that's called dispersion. In dispersion, it means that our velocity of propagation is a function of frequency. It may mean that high frequency fields travel faster or that low frequency fields travel faster. Remember that the velocity of propagation for a lossless line is C naught divided by the square root of epsilon r. Let's imagine what would happen if epsilon r varied with frequency. This would be very typical in any material such as water or other fluids because the polarity of the molecules is very different for different frequencies. In that case, the velocity of propagation would vary with frequency, and each part of the wave would travel differently. If we had a simple sine wave, this wouldn't cause any dispersion. It would mean that this frequency of sine wave and this frequency of sine wave might propagate with different velocities, but in general, this entire wave would propagate with one single velocity, and this wave would propagate with another different single velocity. But if we are using a pulse, let's suppose we've got a rectangular pulse. This rectangular pulse in time has a lot of different frequencies in it. In fact, kind of has a sync type behavior in the frequency domain.